So my name is Ben Muschko. I'm working as one of the core engineers on the Gradleware team. Today I want to talk about web application deployments, what's possible at the moment. I will run you through a couple of use cases and we'll have a look at practical examples. What are the specific plugins that are helpful in that space? We'll identify all of them and have a look at typical use cases that you have in your project, not only local deployment, but also remote deployment. If you're interested in more in deployment in runtime containers, I'm also going to give a talk later on, which also covers Docker in this case. So if you're interested in that kind of stuff, come to my later talk. So Hans talked about specific studies published by Zero Turnaround. They compare certain tools, languages, how popular they are. And one of these comparisons actually was that they compared build tools, and specifically their features. So in this matrix, we can actually see that they compare Ant, Maven, and Gradle, so mainly build tools out of the JVM space. And one of the criteria that they used to compare their features was the capability of deploying your code. In this case, to application servers, so they have a matrix here which says Tomcat, JBoss, GlassFish, all types of containers that you can imagine that you might have in your project. And we see Maven and they're doing pretty well. They can start and stop the servers. They can also deploy applications. But if we look at Gradle, we see, well, only Jetty and Tomcat is supported. You might ask yourself, is that really the case? So hopefully it's not. And today we'll actually talk about that. We'll run through some use cases here that also cover other application servers. So if you look at Gradle as the build tool, if you're coming from Ant and Maven, you see all these nice features that the build tool provides: flexibility, you can write plugins easily, convention over configuration, and you can use Groovy, and so on. But if you look at your day-to-day job, is this all you need? Or is it more the daily routine of changing code, deploying it to your local server, and how does this actually also look like if you wanted to deploy any code to a remote machine, or especially to production? So you think, Gradle might be a little bit immature, so let's not move on because it doesn't even cover simple deployment capabilities. But if you ask yourself what deployment even means, you really have to ask yourself the question, in my case, what needs to be covered when I talk about deployment? So does that mean local deployment just to a development machine, for example, in an embedded container? Does this mean deploying your code to remote machines, any QA server, production, these kinds of things? Or does it even mean more complex kind of use cases and processes? For example, you have to stop the server first, deploy your code, back up the log files, do specific things like copying files around, and then start the server again, or even rolling deployments. So I think this problem space is far more complex than Zero Turnaround lined out here. So let's have a look at the typical types of containers that we might have in your projects. So if you're familiar with the Jetty plugin, it's part of the core Gradle distribution. It's an embedded container implementation, so it allows you to point to your specific source code or your build classes, and you can run your Jetty container as it is. You simply point it to source. You don't even have to create a WAR file in that sense. So that's kind of convenient. Starts up pretty quickly, so in container testing is possible as well. You can bring it up, and something similar exists for Tomcat as well. So there's another Tomcat plugin which also works on the embedded container implementation. Alternatively, you can bundle the WAR file, deploy it to your Tomcat as well, which is also possible with the Jetty container. So you have all the possibilities here. It's pretty convenient because you can run it within the JVM of Gradle itself. Currently, these two plugins don't actually provide functionality to also fork off a specific process. That's something that we want to support, or that I personally want to support because I'm the author of the Tomcat plugin. And that's something that people ask about all the time. They potentially want to provide memory parameters separately just for Tomcat, these kinds of things. So in development, this is pretty convenient. There might be other embedded container implementations that are potentially not wrapped as plugins that I'm not aware of. But it's fairly easy to write your own. For example, if you wanted to go for, I don't know, WebLogic or something else, that's pretty simple. Another use case, if you want to deploy to a standalone container, that means you take the distribution of that application server. In this case, I'm showing Tomcat as one example, but it could be anything, basically. Download it from the official web page, extract it on your local machine, and then pretty much bundle your artifact and deploy to it. The benefit of that is it might actually look more production-like, so you might actually use the same distribution in other environments like QA, production, what have you, staging. You have all the configuration files, but in this, this case, you actually have to bundle the artifact first. So it's not so convenient for development. You always have to compile your code, create the artifact, and then copy the file over. So usually you drop it into some sort of web apps directory for hot deployment. So that's one example of a container type. And we have another container type, which is pretty much the standalone container, except that it lives on a different machine, on a remote machine. That could be the case if you have multiple machines running in QA, staging, production. Sometimes you even have a cluster of machines. So again, here you have to create the artifact, push it up. But in this case, it's slightly more complex because you have to cross network boundaries. You might have to provide credentials, so it's protected, so you have to authenticate yourself. So you can see there are different types of problems that you might face as a developer in your projects. So what are specific plugins that you have in the Gradle space currently available? So we know the Jetty plugin here. It's a core plugin, provides basic functionality. It actually comes with a baked-in version of Jetty, which is kind of inconvenient because some guys actually want to use a different version. And we say, well, currently you cannot easily change this. But if you wanted to be more ambitious about Jetty, you can go back to the Gradle plugin, which is a open source plugin, which provides deployment capabilities for Jetty. But it also allows you to configure different versions. It's actually pretty nice. You can also do bytecode reloading in place. So it really helps you a lot. So if you really want to use Jetty, I would actually recommend going for this one here. If you're using Tomcat, you can use my plugin. And I know people want to have new features all the time, but I rarely get to it these days. Currently, we are supporting 7 and 8 as versions. There's a pull request currently open to also support 8. So I assume will become more popular over time here. And what do you do if you don't have Jetty or Tomcat, which is the case in a lot of enterprises? They might use WebLogic or GlassFish or something else. For that purpose, there's another plugin which provides embedded container implementations. It's called the Achillean plugin. The reason for that is it actually sits on top of the Achillean tooling provided by Red Hat. They usually use it for in container testing. But in this case, you can actually choose the server that you want to use in your build. And that could be a different one than just Jetty or Tomcat. And you can even configure multiple different types of containers. So we'll talk about pretty much this guy and this guy, so the Achillean plugin, pretty early stage in development. But I should be able to give you a first taste on how this looks like. So if you look at the Gradle plugin for Tomcat, we actually broke this out, and that's a best practice in Gradle in general. So you usually want to split up your logic into conventions and capabilities. In this case, the Tomcat plugin gives you all the conventions, so it sets certain ports for you out of the box. For example, 8080, pretty useful if you don't want to change that. It provides default standard tasks out of the box that are simply added. And it also provides a DSL for configuring that specific plugin. So I can say I want to actually change my port and point it to something else, or I want to use SSL. Certain things can be configured here. If you really want to create your own conventions, or if you don't want to use the standard tasks that are provided by the Tomcat plugin, you can always fall back to the Tomcat-based plugin. It gives you the capabilities, in this case, the custom task types to start up a Tomcat or stop it, these kinds of things. And it also slightly pre-configures some things, for example, setting the class path to your embedded implementation, these kinds of things. So let's actually see that guy in action. And this actually looks fairly similar with the Jetty plugin as well. So if you want to adapt this example, you can. So here we see we actually apply the convention plugin. It has the identifier called Tomcat. We pull it from Maven Central currently. And in the dependencies, we assign the version of Tomcat we want to use. In this case, it's Tomcat 6 to a specific configuration, which is exposed by the plugin. So pretty handy. So you can pick your own version that you want to use in your build. So you don't have to necessarily say, I'm only using 7.1 something, which is currently the case with the Jetty plugin. And then you can use the DSL here to actually configure it. So here we're actually reconfiguring certain standard values. So we say HTTP port should be 8090. We want to use SSL, but we also want to use a different port for that. In this case, we actually use the task that is provided by the convention plugin, which is by default called Tomcat run. With that, you basically bring up your Tomcat and also deploy your current web application project to that running Tomcat. So pretty handy. If you wanted to write your own tasks, and that could be the case if you wanted to build that into a specific workflow. For example, if you wanted to have functional tests and run your functional tests against a locally against a local instance of Tomcat as an embedded container, you can easily create your own tasks. And for that, I would simply use the base plugin. It gives you the capabilities, in this case, the custom task types. And you can see these are the classes that are used for that. And of course, you can configure all of them. Here we say set a certain stop port so we can actually later on bring it down. And it should run as a background thread. That's actually not a different process. Just keep that in mind, just runs in the background as a thread. And here we simply say, when we run the functional tests, bring up Tomcat first, wait until you're up, run our specific functional tests against that instance, and then later on, simply with the finalized by, pretty handy. If you haven't used that, that's comes certainly in handy for this kind of use case. Tear down certain resources. In this case, the resource is the embedded Tomcat container. So all you need to do then, run your functional test. And of course, functional tests would have more logic here. For example, you want to configure your class path, these kinds of things. You want to provide system properties. But that's one way of using the base plugin as well. So how does a typical development workflow look like if you just work on a web application? You usually would start Tomcat run, which brings up Tomcat. Then you have a look at your browser, which you can reload and see your servlet that is rendered. But oops, well, there's some sort of typo which we want to fix, any kind of logic that you want to change. So we simply say change the code. We have to recompile, unfortunately, bring down the server, and restart Tomcat. So kind of like not so convenient. I mean, granted, Tomcat starts up pretty quickly, but still it's kind of like, yeah, you have to manually do this all the time. You might have some sort of like shell script that does it for you. Not preferred, but there's actually a better way. And if you're familiar with tooling like Grails, they have something like bytecode reloading in place. So you leave your server running for a while. You make changes to your code, and some sort of daemon or background process would actually pick this up, recompile it, and actually use it within your running instance by bytecode swapping. So that's one possibility as well. So same use case. We start Tomcat. We see the typo here, which we want to fix. You change the code, recompile with compile Java, and then the Tomcat container will actually take care of reloading the bytecode. So that's actually preferred in local development. You want to have a rapid development lifecycle here. So what are the typical functionalities that we can use here? So the Tomcat plugin, as well as the Jetty plugin, have built-in capabilities. So you can configure them to enable bytecode reloading by default, and then you're all set. Or you can simply use JRebel, which works pretty well for more complex kind of use cases. It's a commercial product, so if you haven't tried that out, that works as well. So let's have a look at the Aquilion plugin. So if you don't want to use Jetty or Tomcat, what do you do? So I mentioned before, it's pretty early stage, and it's called the Achillean plugin. You will find it on my GitHub repo as well. So what the Achillean plugin allows you to do is to read a JSON file, and that JSON file is provided by Red Hat in general. That's something that they want to provide out of the box. And that JSON file defines the dependencies needed for a specific container, as well as all the properties that you can use to configure that container. For example, the port, whether it should run with SSL, and so on. So what the plugin does, it reads that JSON file, it configures the specific dependencies out of the box, depending on what type of container you have configured. And then it brings up the specific container as an embedded implementation as well. In the long run, we also want to provide other types of containers, in this case, managed containers or remote containers. So that's going to come up at some point of time. Just to give you an idea how this looks like in terms of the DSL that is exposed, we have the Achillean plugin here. Currently, I'm not showing that I actually apply the plugin. Assume that's already happening. But what we do here, we have this DSL, which starts with the configuration element Achillean. You can set it to debug true or false just to get more information about what's happening under the covers. You can point it to a single deployable, and that deployable could be a WAR file, EAR file, even a JAR file in this case. And then we have another configuration block here, which is called containers. And in this case, we have actually two containers that we can configure. So Jetty and Glassfish, these are identifiers that we look up in the JSON file. And then we provide the specific version and the type. Keep in mind, at the moment, only supported embedded containers. And we set certain configuration as well as we like. Otherwise, it simply falls back to the default values here. But that's kind of handy if you wanted to have multiple containers, different types of containers in your build and support it. Sometimes, well, your manager might ask you support not only Jetty, but Tomcat also, because we never know what the client wants. So it's possible. What the plugin does, it puts together a specific task name based on what you have configured here. So basically, the task name to get it started would be Achillean run, and then basically Jetty as a capitalized name. Same thing for Glassfish. So you can basically start up different containers for your build, pretty handy. And I think there's not so much configuration in terms of custom logic that you have to add here. Pretty much works out of the box. So if you want to contribute to that guy, I would highly appreciate it. Still early stage, and people are just starting to try it out. But if you wanted to get familiar with it, have a look at the GitHub page. So let's talk about standalone containers for a second. Standalone containers are supported as well in Gradle. And for that, we have a pretty handy library that we can use called Cargo. It's actually not coming out of the Gradle space in any kind of form. It has been around for many years, actually. And you can deploy your artifacts to different types of containers as a standalone installation. So there's an Ant task and a Maven plugin as well. So if you wanted to use it in different build tools, you can. But there's also a Gradle plugin for that. And now we can actually see that pretty much all containers are supported that we can think of. So Glassfish, Jetty, WebSphere even, WebLogic, JBoss, and even some of the newer ones here, like Wildfly. So that's pretty handy. Of course, there's a plugin for it. And basically what we do, we wrap the Ant task provided by that library, which exposes the specific functionality. So we don't actually have to re-implement that stuff. And again, same practice here. So we have plugin composition. We break out capabilities from conventions. If you usually get started with Cargo, that's a good way to start, just with the regular conventions, with the default tasks. That's an option. And if you want to be more ambitious, you can go back to this guy. So let's talk about some use cases here. Specifically, first, deploying to a local container. Pretty typical. You spawn up a process, and you want to deploy your WAR file. So what do you need to do to configure that Cargo plugin? So you apply the plugin here, has the identifier Cargo. And then, again, a DSL configuration block where we say the container ID should be Tomcat 7 in this case. And the container ID can actually be retrieved from the web page. Cargo provides all these IDs, so you have to use one of them. It's predefined. We set a specific port, so if you wanted to have a different one than 8080, in this case, we say 9090. And then we have another configuration block here to deploy to a locally installed Tomcat instance. We point it to the home directory. We can even set certain properties like the timeout and provide specific properties for that specialized container that is, for example, in this case, only exposed by Tomcat. It's not available for WebLogic or something else. And then we simply say cargo run local, and it brings up the local container by pointing to this home directory here. So that's pretty handy. But what if you actually have more than one deployable? And I know some people actually ask for this on the Gradle forums as well. So I wanted to run this by you guys as well. So here we see we cannot only depend on the specific code that we built with this WAR project. We can also say we point it to other deployables that maybe just sit in the file system. Oftentimes, your application actually is combined of multiple services that you need to deploy in a single server. So you have the option here as well, multiple deployables, in this case a WAR file, in this case an EAR file, and we can even expose specific HTTP contexts for that. So great, that works. Again, we point it to the home directory here, and then we can bring up the server again. So usually, developers at some point of time, you're getting kind of lazy, you know, like you want to actually say, I don't want to install Tomcat anymore. I actually want to point it to some sort of zip file, which is the distribution. And I want this plugin to do its thing. It simply downloads the distribution, extracts it on my local disk, and simply starts it from there. So that's also possible and pretty nice. So the concept sounds kind of familiar. If you had a look at the Gradle wrapper, so similar concept here. So download the specific runtime container, extract it, and run it from there. So what do you need to do in the cargo plugin? So there's a new block that we hadn't had a look at yet called installer. We point it to the URL that we find the zip file at, and then we can have different directories here. One defines where it should be downloaded to, and the other one says, I want to extract it to that specific directory here. Again, that's all that is needed. Pretty handy again. But also, let's talk about remote deployment, because oftentimes you not only want to stay in your local development environment, actually want to push something out to a remote machine. And if possible, we also want to use the same kind of logic or plugin. So the process should optimally look the same. Some challenges here. So we actually have to cross network boundaries. Push something to a remote machine, provide username, password, these kinds of things. So let's try this out as well. For that, you have a different configuration block called remote. It provides a host name. It has the port, username, password. Of course, in this case, I just gave some passwords and username in the build script itself. This, of course, should be externalized. It shouldn't be checked in with your code into version control. Keep in mind, you can have the local configuration block as well as the remote configuration block side by side. So you can say which one you actually want to deploy. And for that one, you call a different task, which is called cargo deploy remote. So far, we can only configure a single container. But again, real life might look more complex, where we want to say, we want to deploy to Jetty as well as Tomcat, but we also want to deploy to multiple different remote machines. And in this case, pretty handy again, the cargo base plugin, which provides us with the capabilities, in this case, the custom task types. So we import the classes here. These are the definitions of what needs to be done when we deploy. And here we say cargo run local is the class. Create a new task here, configure the container ID, point it to the home directory. And the same thing we do here for a local Jetty container. Same concept applies here. And for remote machines, you can set the specific properties as well. You can see that the names of the properties are pretty much the same as exposed by the DSL. So that is pretty much the same here. So what if you wanted to deploy to multiple machines? So oftentimes you have a cluster of machines, for example, in QA, to do scaling, load balancing, these kinds of things. So even in production, where you say, if we deploy a new version of our product, then please put it on three different machines. So that's supported as well. And here we actually have to add a little bit more custom logic. So here we basically model this kind of domain in a specific kind of way. So pretty easy, actually. So we say we define the specific properties needed for a remote container, for example, the name, hostname, port, username, password, these kinds of things. And then we create a list of these remote containers, which we simply assign values to. So you can see username, password, port, these kinds of things. Of course, you can externalize this kind of configuration as well. So you don't have to have it in your build script. This could also go into build source or into the plugin. Kind of depends on where you want this to live. Currently, I'm just showing this within the build script. And then we can simply create tasks dynamically. So we basically take that list of remote containers that we have defined. We iterate over each element within that list and take the specific configuration to build up a specific task with the name that we configured. And the name pretty much is, for example, Tomcat 1, Tomcat 2. In this case, we just capitalized that name. So it would be named Deploy Remote Tomcat 1, Tomcat 2, Tomcat 3. We set the specific configuration that we added to the POJOs, or the instances of them. So that gives us the capability to deploy to specific Tomcat containers. But you can also write an aggregation task, which simply has a list of dependencies. So if you wanted to deploy to everything, one after another, you can. And for that, we simply say depends on, and we simply iterate over the collection of containers, build the names as we did up here, and then we have direct task dependencies. So if you run this guy, it will actually deploy to each container one by one. So if you wanted to deploy to multiple environments, use the same logic, but deploy to multiple environments, you can do that as well in Gradle, fairly simple. There's no built-in capability that Gradle has, nothing like profiles or something like that that we have in the Maven world, but it's actually fairly simple to achieve. So we can simply provide a project property on the command line. In this case, we can simply say dash P env equals a specific environment that we define. So we deploy to different environments here. Based on the specific configuration flag that we provide on the command line. Internally in your script, you could then decide, based on the project property, what logic to run, use that specific configuration needed for a specific environment, and then use the same kind of logic to deploy it again. So that's actually fairly simple. If you wanted to externalize that configuration into script plugins, you can, and decide based on the project property that is provided. It's fairly simple. I'm not going to show an example, but that's pretty much how we can solve it. So what's the problem with cargo in general? So you think that this looks great. I can actually use that for all my environments, even deploying it to production. But at some point of time, you will actually notice that you run into an out-of-memory error. And the reason is that cargo does hot deployment all the time. So it doesn't out-of-the-box start or stop the specific container. And that's certainly something that we don't want to have in production. So we don't want to leave it hanging there, recognize that it's not up anymore at some point of time. Of course, you should put some sort of monitoring in place to recognize that kind of situation. But this would basically be happening in production. Independent of how high you set your primgen space, at some point of time, you will hit that space because the old classes are simply not cleaned up. So for that, of course, you would have to stop the container. In between, we basically deploy the artifact or the new version of that artifact. So that would be kind of like the lifecycle that you would have to run if you would deploy to a specific container remotely. So how do you make this happen with cargo? At least there's some support now with some of the latest versions. So what they provide now is a so-called daemon process, which you can download from the web page as well. So the daemon process basically has to be started on the same remote machine that you want to deploy to. And you can communicate with that daemon. So you can basically say, with that web page that the daemon exposes, I can configure specific remote machines. In this case, we give it some sort of handle ID. In this case, I call it Tomcat7. And you can see there are multiple buttons that we can call, stop, start, view some logs, and so on. So that's all possible. And then from the Gradle process, we can trigger these commands as well. So they're basically exposed. Downside is, well, you have to install that daemon on all remote machines, which is kind of like not so handy. But it's possible. So you can make it happen with Cargo if you want to. And there's also, again, support for that in the Gradle plugin. For that, we support two different custom task types. One is called Cargo Daemon Stop, the other one Start. And then in this case, we simply create new tasks for them with that specific type. We provide the handle ID that I was talking about. That's the one you configure in that web page. And we provide the specific host name that we want to target. You can also provide username, password, so you can also protect that daemon in some form. And then we simply say, whenever we redeploy to a remote machine, please depend on stopping the container and starting the container. And we want to ensure that task order is enforced here. And Hans was talking about that. For that, you can use must run after. So you can say, before I actually want to start the daemon, we actually want to stop it first. So that's kind of like the workflow you can use for remote machines, kind of handy. But then, again, I talked about this in the beginning. Usually deployment is more than just hot deploying a specific file to a container, starting and stopping it. So oftentimes you want to back up logs or do whatever you need to do to make it happen. So the process actually could look fairly complex. And we just had a question on the Gradle forum that, when I asked about it, basically revealed that they have such a process. So it's usually not just about copying files. So you really want to go the extra mile to also enable yourself to be able to deploy to production. So Cargo doesn't give you any support for that. So that's that. So I talked about Cargo like in full breath, but with that, it actually doesn't help you. So it's fairly OK for local development environments, either for that or for QA environments, where it's not so important to make sure that everything works in a certain kind of way. But if you look at specific environments, you should have the same process in place to make sure that if you test out your process in one environment, this looks pretty similar in production then. So what can you do? I would always recommend, if you have a Linux, Unix machine, go back to SSH, which gives you full control. So let's assume we had created a custom task called SSH exec for execute. It's pretty simple to create that. You can simply wrap the and task for making SSH commands or calls. And we can see here, we can provide specific commands or multiple, and then basically chain them together. So in this case, we basically say, shut down the Tomcat server, delete the web apps directory with the old artifacts, delete the work directory, and then later on, at some point of time, we simply start Tomcat again. So you can build your own workflow based on SSH commands. That's possible. I think you should probably abstract that into a custom plugin that you have in your organization then. So this gives you full control over everything. So I would not call Cargo very suitable for production environments just because you don't have fine-grained control. If you want to go easy on SSH calls, there's a plugin for that. That's actually pretty good. It's called the SSH plugin. It's an open source plugin that you can use, which lets you define multiple remotes with the help of a specific DSL. So in this case, we simply say localhost, but you could have like Tomcat 1, 2, 3 again, pretty handy. We can provide SSH keys and so on. And then we can build our specific workflow with the help of that plugin. So we can see we create a new session which targets that local host. So it's one of the defined remotes here. And then we can execute a whole chain of specific SSH commands, pretty handy. Of course, you can have any more custom logic here, if else, what have you. But if you do that, you might want to externalize that again into a plugin. So let's talk about deployment in the context of build pipelines. So there are certain contexts that I want to talk about. So if you talk about a build pipeline, you usually talk about orchestrating certain steps from getting your code compiled over running specific tests, and at some point of time you want to deploy it to production. That's pretty much the end goal here. In the continuous delivery book, they also talk about a deployment pipeline. So you can see the importance of deployment in general in such a build pipeline. And you not only deploy to production, you also deploy to specific other environments. And for these other environments, you should actually make sure that you use the same kind of logic. So if you have your process defined, it's pretty simple to test them out in no non-crucial environments, for example, QA, UAT, and so on. But in production, you should use the same kind of process, and you used it before multiple times, you know it works. So that's your end goal here. So when we talk about continuous delivery, oftentimes you encounter push button releases. So you wanna, before you actually deploy to production, you wanna run your full build pipeline. You might want to run automated functional tests, or in this case, acceptance tests. Of course, manual testing has happened before. And then you tell business, well, it's ready, or they actually look at some sort of dashboard, and they can basically push a button, push it out to release, which would basically trigger your custom SSH process or however you implemented that. When we talk about continuous deployment, that looks slightly different. In this case, we actually push it out no matter what. So once it passes all the quality gates in our build pipeline, we automatically push it out with the help of our process. This might not work for your individual organization, depending on how your release cycle looks like and so on. But in this case, usually you push it out many times a day. Whenever we say the quality is good, move on. You push it out to production. And this, of course, would look totally different for desktop applications. So that's fairly specific to web applications. So in desktop applications, you simply might create some sort of distribution that you hand out to clients, some sort of image or what have you. One thing that you should keep in mind if you build such a build pipeline, once you create the artifact, you should keep it in some sort of binary repository. That's a good practice here. I'm showing Artifactory. It doesn't have to be Artifactory. It could be Nexus or something else. So you push it up once with a specific version. So you have a registry of specific versions that you published. And then at some point of time, you say, I don't want to rebuild my artifact every time I want to deploy, because that might actually introduce specific errors in my artifact. So something can go wrong, and it will go wrong at some point of time. So a good practice is actually to bundle the artifact once, deploy it to a binary repository, and then whenever you want to deploy it to a specific environment, you simply trigger your logic, it takes it out of the artifactory repository with a specific version, and then you push it out. That's also helpful if you at some point of time wanted to roll back to a specific version, so kind of handy. It always gives you the option here. So far, we mainly talked about push deployment, so we basically get it from Artifactory and then from some sort of process, in this case Gradle, we push it up to the remote machine with a specific version. I can see more and more clients move towards a different approach, which is called pull deployment. So basically, they just say we bake an image and it pulls a specific artifact and makes it part of that image. We simply run that image in a specific environment, or this could be pulled from a RPM repository, which is could be enabled in Artifactory as well. So it not only allows you to add artifacts to Maven repos or Ivy repos, you can also create your artifact as an RPM, and then whenever you basically want to deploy, you pull the latest version out of the RPM repo and make it happen. So basically the only thing you do from Gradle, you trigger that process, and that's what needs to happen. So these are kind of like the resources I have. Later on, I mentioned earlier that I'll also talk about virtualized runtime environments. So this is something that I'm going to cover in the next talk, I think in about 2 hours. So if you're interested in that kind of stuff, creating images that also contains your artifact as part of the image. It will also cover Docker. So everybody talks about Docker these days, so I need to do that as well. So if you have any questions now, would be a good time to do that. I'm not going to talk about any kind of like other custom solutions. So you might actually decide to go with other things like Fabric, which uses Python, or Glue, which there's a Gradle plugin for as well. These are kind of like custom solutions. They are more complex, and you actually have to set up certain infrastructure to make it happen beforehand. But these are other options that you might go with. They are not necessarily out of the Gradle world, but they are usable. So I know that one client actually used Fabric for their complex kind of structure process that they had defined, and that works pretty well for them. Any questions? At the moment, it doesn't. So it's only the currently created artifact in the war project that you're in. So if you wanted to do that, yeah, it would be nice if we would have that feature, because you still want to use embedded container implementations just to make it fast and speedy. With that, you would probably have to go with the cargo plugin, or basically submit a pull request, or let me look. I mean, basically, what you probably also should do is create smoke tests. So after you deploy, run a suite of smoke tests, ping certain URLs. That's actually also something that I'm going to cover in my next talk. So I'm actually not covering it here. But you could write a basically a suite of smoke tests and run it from Gradle as well. So you can say, ping at least Tomcat home directory, home URL, also ping certain other URLs that I expect to be there after I deploy my application. And if it doesn't respond within, let's say, 20 seconds, then do something, notify somebody, send an email, these kinds of things. That's what I would do in this case, yeah. Oh, sure. So the question was, how do I identify whether a hot deployment worked or not? Is there any kind of way to actually query the server for log files or anything else? And my response was, create a set of smoke tests and try to identify whether it's up and running.
Have you found that that's where the best pattern is, to make the task for every little discrete step?
So the question is, if you have start and stop tasks and you wanted to enforce a restart in case it, for example, doesn't work, can this be modeled in the build? And is this a good pattern from my perspective? Does that cover it, kind of ish? I probably wouldn't do it. I usually would probably create smoke tests in this case to identify whether something worked. But you could also have something like, and that's not provided, some sort of retry logic. So if it fails, we could say retry multiple times. If it fails, then try it again 5 times, but only have a specific task for it. I mean, it's possible with custom tasks, so we could do that. But I think there should be a deeper logic to it. At least that's my perspective on it. I personally haven't used that kind of stuff so far in production. Do you have like a specific use case that you have?
I just see this pattern where someone puts in great useful logic in a task, people want to call it 3 times. Mm-hmm. So you got to create the task 3 times.
Yeah, I would basically provide this, expose this as part of the configuration of that task.
Would you say that some of the plugins you reference, is some of the logic available for directly calling, or do you have to create tasks to access
it? You would have to create tasks. So we usually say directly calling tasks. We usually call it an entity pattern. So you shouldn't actually call the execute method on a task. I would basically provide this as some sort of configuration. And then internally, once you run that task, it should figure out that it needs to do that. So if it fails one time, try it again, and so on. That's my take on it. Any more questions? Otherwise, I think we're done. Thank you.